Hello and welcome to the Plaid Sheep Oracle, Virgo. I've been pulling a card from my new Wisdom of the Sacred Bee Oracle, and you got the same card as Leo, Dreams. And there are other Leo connections, and there does seem to be this connection between Virgo, Leo, and Cancer. And I think it has to do, in part at least, with planet retrogrades. We began last year with Venus retrograde in Leo solely, moving back and forth. She was there for about 4 months. And she usually spends barely a month, less than a month in a sign. And then Mercury was retrograde recently. He went from Virgo into Leo and back. He just left his shadow on September 12th. And then Mars, who is currently in Cancer, is going to make it all the way to about 6 degrees of Leo and then turn around and come back to 17 degrees of Cancer. So there's something connecting those three. At least here for us in this collective. And it may be my connection to Venus that is somehow, you know, that is pointing this out, or that that all of you that come here maybe have a connection in some way to Venus. Perhaps she's prominent in your chart, or maybe there's just something here for you. And it happens to come through me because I have a strong connection to Venus. So the other cards that have come out in the visible underlying is the Bee Wisdom. And this is all the skills that we have. It's actually a very sort of Virgo-ish card. It's those, all the stuff that happens during the day. One of the examples in the book, in the little booklet that comes with the deck about bee wisdom, is that they bring water to the hive when it's hot, and it gets spread out in a thin layer across the brood. And then the drones flap their wings and evaporate the water, and it cools the hive. So all these different ways that, you know, bees have of dealing with the everyday challenges. And below that is optimism, a general sense of well-being, a general sense that all is well. There may be challenges along the road, there may be, you know, temporary detours or whatever, but that overall, there is a sense of optimism. And I think that in our natural state, that we human beings are optimists, most of us anyway, and maybe all of us, perhaps. But it is easier for some of us to express than for others. I'm something of a worrier, but overall, my kind of base perception is one of optimism. And I just sometimes forget that. Now, the unseen thing here is anguish. And I think the anguish that we're talking about here is of not perceiving your own dreams. But we are coming into a space where this is going to be more possible for you. It could be because we are about to switch over in the nodes. The nodes are going to move from Aries Libra to Pisces Virgo. So the ways in which maybe you've been holding yourself back or holding yourself in, the constriction, the corseting, the excess corseting that you've been using will be easier to release as the South Node passes through Virgo. Because we have here the Ace of Swords. It feels like a breath of fresh air. Not even really a new idea, but a breath of fresh air. The ability to really take a deep breath. You know, if you've laced your corset too tight, then you can't take a deep breath. Below that is both the King of Swords and the King of Pentacles. And that's very Virgo too, this air element with Mercury as your guide, this strong intellectual quality that Virgo has. Also this sense of service, of, you know, holding something larger than oneself. And then the King of Pentacles is a very practical aspect of Virgo. Getting things done, having things organized, being very particular. The body, all of those earthy Virgo things. Below that is the Tower. Oh, and I'm gonna go one more because she's there, is the Star. And it is, usually we think of the Star being the light inside the Hermit's lantern. And the Hermit is associated with Virgo. And maybe you've been, I don't know, ignoring your Star, not feeling really focused on your Star. I don't, you know, I think it's gonna vary for you. Your mileage will vary. The very bottom of the deck is this Lady of Cups, Page of Cups. And this was the card on top of the deck when it chose itself. And certainly she is very much about dreams and about your dreams and about believing in them. The Page of Cups is a believer. That monkey song, I'm a believer, that's a Page of Cups sentiment. Believing in love, believing in dreams. Now there's been a lot of stuff at the bottom of the deck, of each of these decks. This one has this Seven of Pentacles, which normally can be a very heavy, or can feel heavy, you know, the waiting, the diligence, the discipline, the patience, all of these things. Sometimes, you know, feeling a little underwhelmed. And then we have the Priestess. She appears several times, and this is her first appearance. Here in her most oracular space as the Sibyl. Seeing the possibilities ahead. Then we get the King of Wands, another king. He appears more than once. The Chariot, lots of movement. Also Cancer showing up. And then the Ten of Cups, fulfillment. Fulfillment. Emotionally. So all of these possibilities. And you are arriving now, Virgo, at a place where this is beginning to open up for you. Where your focus is coming to be on these dreams of yours. this might be for various reasons. This is the Ten of Pentacles. It could be that you have amassed enough resources, and it doesn't just have to be money. It can also be connections and friends, land, wisdom, energetic resources. You have gathered enough resources and skills that you can now really focus on a dream that you've set aside, put on the back burner, didn't think about, weren't ready for. And then with this Three of Cups coming out with the Page. So these three have fire, air, and earth on their heads. And then there's you with your water cup. So if there has been any sense that you needed to go along with the crowd, that you needed to focus on what other people were doing, maybe you needed to follow a family tradition, or some societal, cultural tradition, that you're going to be able to move away from that. With this Five of Swords, you're going to really be able to get clear. Whatever has been fogging up your ability to see ahead, to see where you need to go, to see how to develop this dream, you're now going to get clear on that. This upcoming Pisces full moon may have something to do with it. Mercury will be pretty close to the sun in Virgo when this full moon happens. And Neptune is going to be conjunct the moon across the way in Pisces. There's some Leo energy, but there's also a lot of Pisces energy coming through here as well. The Priestess appears three times. The Hanged Man appears twice. The Moon is here. So these astrological moments, if you're watching this when I post it, may be relevant for you. And then we have the Magician. And I do associate the Magician with Virgo. He is traditionally associated with Mercury. But this, right, this ability to bring something very specific into being, just what is wanted, desired, needed in the moment. Because I do think that Virgo is partly about need, in the way of not need in a desperate, clawing kind of way, but as in necessity is the mother of invention. That Virgo has a problem-solving quality. So Priestess number two. And this one feels concentrated, focused, like she's sending her mind, her spirit outward. Connecting in some way with the mystery and also with source, with that quantum creational realm, because right below her is the Four of Pentacles. In some ways, the earthiest of the earths. The four, the stability, Traditionally a Capricorn card. So this, right, that there's a real understanding of the connection between the energetic and the physical. Below that is temperance. Also seeming very focused, kind of meditative here. And then the bottom of this deck has, first of all, the King of Wands, inspired, ready to take action. Traditionally, Leo. A leadership quality. And leading, I think, not so much leading other people, but leading yourself and being, right, leading your own life. And next to him is the Lovers. The choice, the love-based choice. And then actually the Ten of Pentacles next to that. And here, in a very celebratory way, this Ten of Pentacles is, your focus. But here it's how this, how this is going to spread, how it's going to relate to others around you. That nothing is really a solitary endeavor. Although Virgo has that hermit solitary quality, but you can't break the connection. You can be a hermit or an anchorite and go and live on a pole in the middle of a desert. But that won't break your connection to your community, to the greater whole. Then we have the Ten of Swords, and I'm feeling less corpsishness here than I usually do, and more. It's more of a sense of surrender. Which may be difficult for you, Virgo, or I don't associate the word surrender with Virgo, and yet to truly be of service in a way that isn't draining and depleting and burning out requires a level of surrender so that you can receive energy and resources from outside yourself. And I was, as often happens, watching a little bit of a video this morning, and the person was talking about the connection, right, of surrender and engagement. So that to surrender doesn't just mean to collapse, kind of. That you are open to guidance and receiving, to not being in control of every little thing, but you are also engaged. And I feel that here with the wheel as well, that the wheel turns, the planets move, circumstances change, other people create. It's a co-creational process. There are other people doing things. And you are engaged with it. And then, two, with the Hanged Man, also, right, a sense of engagement that you're not just hanging there. I mean, this card is a little bit, in this deck, is this person doesn't look very engaged. They're hanging from their neck. But there's this key here. Right? The traditional hanged man imagery, and we'll see it a little bit later, shows the hanged man, he is not flaccid. He's not just hanging there. you know, one leg is pulled up, his arms are active. So you don't, you know, it's not like you're giving up all control of everything. You maintain control of your own thoughts, of your own discernment. It's a co-creative process. And then the moon, mystery, nod to the full moon that's coming on September 17th or 18th. The willingness to not see too far down the road. And then the world. With that co-creative idea here, especially. That if you have a sense that you need to pursue only the worthy dreams, you know, things that are sort of openly altruistic, that, you know, if you're gonna start a business, it needs to be a charity or, you know, some sort of nonprofit. That is the only way to be of service to the community. No. Because everything that you do is intertwined. And part of the surrender is maybe not knowing exactly how it all works. I was talking yesterday in Cancer's reading about beavers and beaver dams and lodges and how they change the flow of the water. They are considered a keystone species because they have this large effect on their ecosystem. And that they, you know, they're not hostile. The other animals, you know, hang out in their sphere, in their lodges. They are not, you know, they don't chase others away. They're communal in that way. But they don't, at least I don't think that they do, not on a conscious level, build the dam or the lodge in order to achieve some specific ecological effect. They do what feels right, what looks right, what seems right to them. I think mostly what feels right. And then that has this effect that they cannot predict any more than you can. So we have here a rough, it says rough patch, but it's feeling today more like an empty patch. That there's this empty space or this, you know, this piece of land that you haven't been sure how to cultivate, what to do with it. Do I build a house? Do I make a farm? What do I do with it? Metaphorically or possibly literally speaking. And then with this Four of Swords below it, that maybe you've been really thinking about this. Maybe this is also part of it, that you haven't, not only have you perhaps not been focused on it, but you haven't known when you do focus on it, where to go and how to go. Maybe you've spent a lot of time sort of meditating on it, hoping for inspiration, and it hasn't been forthcoming. But now, this Five of Wands was clamoring, just, you know, kind of wanting to be looked at, wanting to be seen. So inspiration, a fire in the mind is coming. And it may not be what you expect, because the card immediately next to this is the weight of a snowflake. And this is to me a kind of Cinderella energy. This dress coming into being from snowflakes and starlight. That there is something unexpected that is going to come, something that you could not have predicted, something that you do not control. But now is the time, you are now open to it. Stuff is aligning in some way. Again, I think don't worry about it. I have a tendency to ask these questions like, what is happening? What, why is this happening now? What is this about? I have a south node in Virgo. But it isn't really necessary to know. And next to that is the Ace of Pentacles, which has shown up in every reading, I think, since the collective reading that I did where it showed up. So there is something happening in our little collective here about this new pentacle, this new state of being, this new physical reality, perhaps. That I think we just don't, there isn't enough information yet. It is unfolding. Actually, the card next to this anguish on the bottom is the unfolding. So we have the Three of Pentacles in this deck, very collaborative. If you don't have a collaborator, I think you're going to find one. It may be collaboration with spirit, or almost certainly is, but there may be additionally somebody else as well. Then we have this crone who is a bit of this surrender energy. In the other cards, that there's a maiden and a mother too. And the maiden is holding on and she's kind of being pulled by the moon. And then the mother is sort of surrendered to the moon's pull. She's wrapped around her waist and is being carried by the moon. And then the crone has let go of this. It's like getting to a next level of connection. When that string is no longer necessary. I want to say it's like taking the training wheels off the bicycle. That any hedging of bets, any plan A, B, C, and D in your mind, thinking about, well, I have this dream, to be a singer, but if that doesn't work out, I can always go and, be a real estate agent, right? Or, go back to my office job or whatever it is. We're not doing that. No kind of security blanket. Right? For Cynthia Leviosa, just taking off with enthusiasm, with abandon. I watched a reading this morning by my lovely friend Erica of Do You Tarot. And in the reading I chose, the word frugal came up and she was looking for something opposite that, an antonym to frugal. And that sent me sort of online to look up. I thought of a couple of things in my own head, but I went and looked it up and there were, many lovely words. Luxurious, opulent, open-handed, hedonistic, extravagant. Generous, voluptuous, so this make this right taking the corset off, and so may timid wings waken. Right, that corset may have been trapping your wings as well, so they couldn't open fully. And so we have the healing heart. And all of these things, you know, that we do are part of this, right? Part of this process of expansion, of healing, of opening, of realizing. Under this we have, not surprisingly, let it go. And then the deep underlying, we have the call of the muse, exposed and revealed. And I think this is more about this dream being exposed and revealed. And maybe this is that you get to a point where you reveal it, expose it to other people. That might have been another factor that you didn't want other people to know. Either because it was weird or because you were worried about people interfering or whatever, right, whatever your reason was, or you just wanted it private. Now we may be seeing it more. And also this card, which just keeps coming out, into me, I see real clarity about yourself, about what your dreams are now. Because dreams change, desires change through our lives. I mean, this may be a dream that you've had for a long time, but it has probably matured. And now you're seeing it in its current space. So waking the lion, naturally. And then the spirit of gratitude. And gratitude in a really open way. You know, gratitude can have a resistant quality, a sense of, oh, you know, thank goodness, or oh, you know, thank God I have this, otherwise I would be destitute, or I would be, right? There's a kind of gratitude can have a very, it can have a needy quality to it. Can have a forced quality to it. Oh, you know, I have to be grateful. This is the more open version. The really lighthearted. I'm so grateful. This is so wonderful. I so appreciate this. It's so beautiful. There's no sense of need or grasping, no sense of anguish. Right, a lightness, an opening, a blossoming. And then the storyteller. What do you want to write? Where does the story go from here? You know, this is a blank book. Whatever has come before is done. This is now a new place. Any ways that you've responded or reacted in the past, any of that past stuff does not have to come with you from here. Now, a card that leapt out of this deck, and actually, I didn't say these three cards all fell out. And normally, I don't take cards that fall out, just occasionally, but these I just left them. So there is a sense of things just happening without your direct control. Virgo, I know that can be a tricky idea. But a card that fell out of this deck, and it didn't, right? It sort of didn't want to be part of this little story. But it's this Knight of Cups, who is this callback, right, to this page. Right, going and filling your cup at a stream of your choosing. And doing it as often as you want. So the formal advice. We start with the Magician. So recognizing yourself as the Magician. It can take some work. Because if we're used to doing things in the physical world through sort of direct physical action of some kind, and that includes, you know, say making a phone call or sending an email or making demands or making a spreadsheet or, you know, any of these things, then it can take some practice to act through the energetic world first, to create something in the energetic world and not act on it until it's really ready to go, until it is manifest. So initially there can be some disappointments. We feel like, you know, well, I tried manifesting that and it didn't come, so I just, you know, went out and did it. It just by its practice. But Virgo, you know, we are good at practice, right? The Virgo energy can be good at practice. Below that is this Five of Pentacles, which does not at all seem like worry to me. This seems like entering the church. So, you know, kind of being converted, essentially, Virgo, to this idea of being the Magician. Becoming a convert to creating first in the energetic space and then acting on it when it comes into being, right? Taking only inspired action rather than, you know, making a whole plan or making a whole spreadsheet and doing things step by step. Below that is the Ace of Wands and the King of Wands reappearing again, here very Leo-ish. The bottom of the deck, there you are, the Knight of Discs. And here in this particular card, so romantic. So romantic. I think you can be romantic, Virgo, in your own way. Allow that for yourself. Allow some romance for you. And then we have the Hanged Man here in his more sort of active position. Right, this leg, the muscles in this leg, the muscles in his body are activated. He's not just hanging there. And then he has this, you know, bee in this eye, right? This giant third eye and this bee. I think of bees as very multidimensional. Much, much more than they appear to be on the surface. right? This bee wisdom. And I think you maybe, right, you have a lot of skills, and now I think you're getting new ones. Just as Odin received the wisdom of the runes while he was hanging there, I think you have been receiving new skills. And that now you just have to practice them. So we have valor, bravery, courage. To take this path, to pursue your dreams. Mars in Leo, traditionally. And then the priestess for the third time. And here, right, she's all intertwined with the bee. And with the moon. This, you know, this feels like a very nature-based priestess. You know, someone maybe who scries in the water or, you know, watches the flights of birds and interprets that. Who speaks to the bees. You know, maybe she is a beekeeper. And they are her eyes into these other dimensions. And then strength. Knowing your own strength and your own strengths. That maybe you have some that you didn't realize. Maybe you have some that are very watery, sort of Piscean or Cancerian or Scorpionic or you know, sort of Taurus, right? There's a lot of kind of earthy nature thing going on here that I associate more with Taurus, right? With Venus. That you have strengths that you may still be unaware of that are going to unfold. And once more, this light, Leo coming through one more time. And I don't quite, right, this Leo connection, this, right, a sense of creativity, of openness, of love. You know, maybe because Pluto is about to move across the way, that's going to activate Leo as well. It's not just about Pluto in Aquarius. It's about all the relationships that he has. Opposite Leo, square the other fixed signs, trine the other air signs. There is, right, there's all these relationships. And so it may be that Leo is taking on an importance. That openness, that childlike view, that ability to shine like the sun without, you know, creating any kind of obligation from anybody. I'm excited for you, Virgo. I hope you're excited by whatever this dream is, or dreams, multiple, by this possibility of new skills and new vistas for you. I wish you the very, very best, and I will see you next time. So long, Virgo.